Hello everybody and welcome to another Substance Designer tutorial. This time around I thought I'd tackle what's a fairly popular material style in the CG art community, and that's the hand-painted texture sets. Now you see a lot of really beautiful looking art on ArtStation, on the Blender Artist Forum, on Sketchfab, everywhere. It's a really ubiquitous, really nice looking art style. You even see it in the AAA gaming industry, for example. Overwatch has some really beautiful, clean, stylized texture sets involved in it. And you see a lot of tutorials in First Substance Designer, which cover how to create all kinds of photorealistic materials, from tiles to wood patterns to metals. But you don't see a lot of tutorials covering how to create stylized things, how to create artistic things, how to create cartoony things. So I thought I'd go ahead and tackle, you know, a really basic tutorial, cover a few interesting techniques that are kind of useful in all sorts of different situations. So what I went ahead and grabbed from Google Images is this as a reference photo. It's a hand-painted kind of roof tile material. I really liked it. So what we're actually going to be creating today is recreating this material I put together earlier today, which is another kind of a wooden roof tile stylized material. Kind of a nice look, I think. So let's go ahead and dive right in. Going to File, New Substance, create a new graph. I'm going to name mine Stylized Tile Tutorial. And you'll see I'm using my own PBR output template. This is a template starting graph that I put together myself. It's based on the physically based metallic roughness, which comes with Substance Designer when you install it, but I've just got a few more nodes in there by default, which I find useful for my workflow, and I'll go over why I have them as we get into this. So let's hit OK, create our new material. Let's move these over, these nodes over a little bit, give ourselves some room. So I got a few questions in my last tutorial about my default setup and why I have it, how I have it. If you don't care to actually hear about, you know, what this default setup is all about, I'm going to leave a timestamp in the description for you to go ahead and skip ahead to us actually getting into the material. But for those of you who are interested in why I have my defaults like this and how you can set up your own default like this, this is for you. So to start with, in my workflow, I'd like to start with creating my height maps first. I like to create the shapes and forms in my material before I ever get on to doing the base color and roughness. So to start off with, I have a normal curvature smooth and ambient occlusion feeding into a base material node, where I have exposed my normal AO and height to begin with. Now I got a few questions about why I use curvature smooth instead of using the raw height maps that I'm creating and plugging that in, and the reason is I tend to take my texture sets as procedural materials into Unity 5. And Unity 5 uses a parallax occlusion algorithm for its height information, and having really contrasty, really noisy height information for parallax occlusion creates really, really ugly, ugly results. So what I like is using this curvature smooth. It gives us a less contrasty, a more muted, more smoothed out and subtle height map, which I find to look really nice for parallax occlusion in Unity in particular. If you want, or if I was going to be taking this into Blender, which I might do later in the tutorial, I would probably use my raw height information, but for parallax occlusion in Unity, I find curvature smooth to be really useful. And you'll see that later on that this is also going to be really useful for creating a hand-painted texture style. Now I feed it all into this base material. If anybody's familiar with sculpting or 3D modeling in your software of choice, you usually work with a model that just has a basic, like a matte cap material applied. And that's really one of the main reasons that I use this base material to start with. It means that I can plug everything in here for my height information and my ambient occlusion so I can see my forms as I'm working, but I can apply a generic base color and roughness value so I have sort of a matte cap material inside the viewport. What it also lets me do is as I get on later and I'm ready to move on to my base color, I can just hit true, toggle on and off that input, and just start working on my base color. And then everything, all of my nodes, all of the parts of my graph feed into one central location and then automatically feed out into my output nodes. Now, the only two extra outputs I have here besides my usual metal roughness ones is I have height and AO by default, so I get the full gamut of outputs for use in Unreal Engine or for Unity or what have you. So I've got base color, normal roughness, metalness, and of course then AO and height. So let's go ahead and start working on our actual material now that we've got all that out of the way. So first things first, we need to go and create the basic shape for our tiles, our roof tiles. So I'm going to grab polygon 2 here from our patterns. I'm going to give it four sides so it's a little bit of a square. I'm going to pull back this gradient way, way, way back. Maybe 0.1. Yeah, let's try 0.1. So we get a little bit of a bevel on the sides there. I'm actually going to scale it up to, say, 1.25. So it mostly fills our frame and takes up takes advantage of a lot of our texture resolution here at 2K. But I get a little bit of room because I'm going to be using some warp modifiers, warp nodes, to give us a little bit more of an organic, wavy, hand-painted feel to it. I'm also going to give it a little bit of curvature, a little bit of a bulge on the edges, which again I wouldn't usually do if I were creating photorealistic tiles like kitchen tiles or floor ceramic or what have you. However, for a hand-painted style, I want a lot of variation. I want a lot of smoothness and organic flow to it, like hand-painted textures tend to be. So I'm going to move this over, give myself some more room, and I'm going to grab a couple noises that I'm going to use for my warping. I think I'm going to grab my Perlin Noise 2 here for my big noise, my big warping. And then Perlin Noise 1 for some smaller detail in here. So I'm going to press space, type warp, drop in our warp node. Let's make sure these are all aligned on the grid nicely. I get a little bit OCD about making sure everything is aligned. So I'm going to plug in our Polygon 2 and plug in our Perlin Noise to our gradient input, and maybe turn the intensity up to like 2.5, say. And that's looking pretty good, I think. You get a little bit of bulging, a little bit of here and there. Maybe I might want it at 3, a little bit more noticeable. That's looking pretty good. So let's go ahead and add another warp node and warp on top of our existing warp. Give us our smaller details here. That might be a little bit too much, maybe 0.75, maybe 0.5, 0.6. I think 0.6 is a good compromise. And now we have our silhouettes for our tile are really kind of broken up a little bit more. It's a little bit more visual interest and a little bit more of an organic hand-painted look. So that's doing pretty well for us. Now the last thing we need to do, again making ourselves a little bit more room, is we're going to add a blend of gradient on top of this. Now the reason for this is we want each of the rows of our tiles to go on top of the next one. So we want the tops of our tiles to be slightly lower than the bottoms of our tiles so it looks like they're one on top of the other. And the other reason is most tiles, if you see them, aren't flat on top of each other. They have a little bit of a slant, a little bit of a slope to them. So we're just going to add in that effect. So we're going to go back to our patterns. I'm going to grab a gradient linear. Let's rotate it by 180 degrees, so the top is going to be dark and the bottom is going to be light. If you don't know about height maps, our height goes from black being our lowest areas of our map and white being the highest areas of our map. So a gradient goes from dark to light, low to high. So a linear gradient like this is going to give us sort of a linear constant slope to our tiles, which is exactly what we are looking for. So I'm going to add a blend node. Let's move this gradient over. I'm going to put in our tile for our background and our gradient for our foreground input. Foreground. I cannot speak today for the life of me. I do apologize. I saw some questions going around on the Substance Tools Facebook group, as well as a couple forums, asking sort of common questions about how do I do this and that with a blend node, how do I combine these and that. So the thing to note about the blend node is that all your controls over here affect our foreground input. The background input is just the background. The foreground is everything that is controlled here. So the opacity slider changes the opacity or the transparency of our foreground input, the cropping, again, of our foreground input, alpha blending, blend mode, all that. That's what it does. If you don't know about blend modes, I suggest you Google blend modes because that's ubiquitous across all software that has 2D image blending, Photoshop, GIMP, Blender, Substance Designer, anything. That is a ubiquitous industry standard, these blending modes, and what each blending mode does. And the opacity mask here, you can put in a black and white mask, and all the white areas, all the black areas, you're not going to get any input. All the white areas, you are going to get your input. So it's just sort of a mask that cuts out everything, and then these controls come into play, which isn't relevant to this tutorial. So you'll my last tutorial, I believe, I used some opacity masking. So if you want to know more about that, I suggest you look at my mandala material. So getting back to this, what we want is to blend the dark blacks and grays on top of the white so we get the slant on our tile. So I'm just going to set my blending mode to multiply to achieve that effect. So now you can see it's darker at the top and lighter at the bottom, so we're going to be sloping from low to high so we get sort of a slanted down effect. Now I'm going to start plugging this tile into our normal and turn up the intensity to maybe 5 so we can really start to see the results in our viewer. It's looking pretty good so far. You can see that it's slanting from the from low to high, sort of popping out of the surface, which is exactly what we were going for. So let's go ahead and start tiling this. So I'm going to add a tile generator. In fact, it's probably going to be easier to grab it from here. Make sure that it's a tile generator, not tile generator color. We're working with height information. That's grayscale, so not color. So I'm going to plug our tile into our pattern input here and make sure that our tile generator is set to our image input. And now you can see that it is using our tiles as the tile it is generating. I'm going to set the number down here to 4x4. Now the first thing I want to do is get rid of the fact that these are in a grid. I don't want them to be aligned to an exact grid. As you can see here, they're sort of offset, mostly sort of in the middle of each other. Not quite, not always, but more or less like that. So I want to go over my offset here and offset by 0.5. So they're sort of halfway in between each of each other. Maybe 0.55, so they're not exactly halfway between each other. Just give, because all of this effect is going to be layering sort of organic levels of variation to really break up the image. So that's pretty good, I think. Yeah. So they're slightly offset now. I think I'm going to turn up the scale variation just a touch, not too much, maybe 0.1, and turn the base scale up to like, say, 1.25. Ah, and we've run into a little bit of a problem here. You can see that where the tiles are overlapping, they're becoming bright white. The reason for this is our blending mode is set to additive. We want it to be max, and now you can see that they are just sort of bumping up against each other and flowing into each other, sort of cutting each other off instead of having that weird overlay. They still look like individual tiles, which is preferable in this case. So I'm going to go down, let's try playing around with free rotation random. That's a little bit too much, maybe 7.5. That's pretty good, I think. Yeah. And then let's play with, say, our luminance variation, maybe 0.5. So it really sort of makes the tiles look individual. Let's go ahead and plug this into our normal output as well so we can really see in our viewer what we're doing. That's looking pretty good so far. So we got lots of tiles overlaying on top of each other. And now the last thing I'm going to do is go down here to our position random, maybe 0.1 and 0.1. So they're not all, so they have a little bit of random offset as well. Because all of this sort of effect is making them look sort of organic and random. That's the big thing right now is to do that. Looking pretty good, I think, so far. Is there anything else we want to do? I don't think so. I think that's all we want to do for now. Alright, so the next part of our effect is I want them to have a little bit of like a wood grain effect. Now, the problem with having like a stylized wood grain effect, I'm going to go ahead and add the noise map I want. I think, Grunge 5 here is the noise map I want to create this effect. I'm going to use this. I'm going to go add a transform 2D. And have it, so it's sort of 2x2, so you get 4 tiles of it. It's going to make it look better in here. Now the problem is, I could blend this straight on top. I could go ahead, plug that into the foreground, plug our tiles into the background, and set this to multiply. And let's just plug this in to see how this looks. I could do this. I could. The problem is, you can see that the grain of this wood grunge pattern flows from tile to tile seamlessly. which isn't what we want, because that actually doesn't look like individual tiles with a wood grain pattern on them. It looks like some wood grain with some, like, tile-shaped notches cut into it. It flows too seamlessly across the surface. It makes it all look like one surface, and that's not what we want. We want each individual tile to have its own, like, separate wood grain effect. So what we could do instead is maybe we could blend it on top of our polygon, except then every single one of our tiles would have the exact same wood grain pattern, and that would be very noticeable. It would be very uniform. Every single tile having the exact same thing, it would be very noticeable that every tile is the exact same tile. And that's not what we want. A lot of what we do in Substance Designer is finding ways to break up our surface so it doesn't look so uniform, so it doesn't look so computer-generated, so it doesn't look so copy-paste. So this is a technique I've seen used for a bunch of different materials, wood floors, brick patterns, all kinds of things, for sort of breaking up a surface in a natural way without having this sort of a repeating issue we would have if we plugged it in here, or the uniformity issue we have if we plug it in here. And what we're going to do is create a vector map out of our tile set. So what we're going to do is copy and paste our tile generator one more time, because we need these tiles to look slightly different than our normal tiles. So let's give ourselves a little bit more room here. Let's move this up and out of the way, move this up and out of the way. And let's go ahead and add a histogram scan. And this is going to let us sort of control the feathering of our gradient map, control how sharp it is, and that's going to be important as we get into our effect here. So let's turn up the histogram scan to maybe 0.8 in the position and maybe 0.8 in the contrast. So you can see we've now sort of gotten rid of some of the beveling, gotten rid of some of the gradients. We've just got a little bit of a tail here. Let's look at our tile generator. The big thing is we want a little bit of the gradient, so we still get the effect of the tiles one on top of the other in our vector map. But we don't want these massive gaps. So I just got to play with the position, play with the contrast, maybe 0.9 and 0.9. That's looking a little bit better. And the other part of this for creating a vector map is we really, really, really want to turn our variance way up, so 0.9. I don't want to go all the way up to 1 because then some of these tiles could be turned black. However, having a 0.9, we get some dark grays, light grays. It really breaks up the luminance variation in our map, which is what we're looking for to create a vector map for the effects that we're going for here. So we have our tiles pretty much set exactly as we need them. So let's go ahead and add a gradient map node. So this is going to be the main portion of our effect here, is turning this grayscale map of varied tiles into a vector map, a color map that we can use for vector warping. So I'm just going to start throwing in colors. I want to leave the black there for the background, so that's separate from everything else. But then the individual tiles, which are everywhere in this grayscale from black to white, I want to set to a bunch of different rainbows of colors. So I want pink, I want purple, I want green. And I want to make sure that, or I want to try to make sure that tiles that are sitting next to each other don't have the same sorts of colors. So having pink on pink here, you're not going to see much of a difference. It's not going to be a massive issue, but as much as we can break up the colors, the better it's going to be. So I think this is fairly broken up. I maybe want to push in the blue a little bit, get some more blue in there, maybe stick something in the middle here to break up the colors a little bit more. What's going to be a good way to break it up? Maybe a little bit of green in here. There we go. So this is going to become our vector map. So for this vector map, I'm going to use a vector warp node, the grayscale version, because we're still working with height information. Luckily, it takes a vector map in color without outputting a color, which is exactly what we want. So let's go ahead and let's move this blend out of the way. And we're going to use this vector warp to warp our wood grain here. So let's plug this into our input, and now you can see if we plug this into our blend instead. Let's turn down the intensity a little bit, because it's a little bit too much to the point that it's hard to see, actually. So let's go ahead and look at this. And now you can see that the wood grain from tile to tile looks more individual. It looks more spread out. It's separated. So the wood grain from here doesn't flow perfectly into here or here, or from here to here. They each have their own separated wood grain, and that's because they each have their own different color, which is how the vector warp sort of moves the pattern around. It sort of uses these colors to pick and divide and move things. Now, on these beveled edges, on these sort of the edges of this gradient where it's going from black to white with a grayscale pattern, you can see we end up with a little bit of a rainbow effect, which means we get a little bit of weird warping. So let's maybe try turning the contrast all the way up, see what that does. I think that hides a lot of the seams pretty well. Now, the other thing to keep in mind is that when we start putting in our base color and really sort of adding shadows and stuff baked into our base color just a little bit, it's going to hide some of these seams, so they're going to be less prominent. They're going to be less of an issue. So all things considered, that's actually going to be perfectly fine, these little tiny bits of seams here and there where the edges are slightly aliased or there's a tiny bit of gradient still left behind. That's actually going to be perfectly fine. We're totally fine. So then the last thing that we need to do is add a little bit of... Actually, there's two more things that we need to do. If we look at our reference photo again, you can see the wood has these little splits in it, which is fairly common for hand-painted wood materials. You usually get little splits and stuff to add some aesthetic visual uniqueness, add a little bit of eye candy. But we also have these little chips, like these little circular wooden chinks knocked out of the wood. So let's go ahead and do that first, because that's really easy. That's just adding a slope blur effect. So we're going to go ahead and use our good old slope blur grayscale. Whoopsies. If you didn't know before, if you click on a node and type in and add a node, it's going to add it right after that node. So unfortunately, I had our histogram scan clicked by accident. I actually want to put our slope blur over here, slope blur grayscale, in between our blend and our normal. Perfect. So let's move these nodes over just a little bit, give ourselves a little bit of room. Same old, same old. And then for our slope blur grayscale, let's find a good map. I think I'm going to use the Gaussian spots here. So we just get these little circular spots where our slope blur is going to be, which should give us our little round chips on our wood, as opposed to my usual... I usually use clouds too, because that gives a really good organic, like a rock erosion effect. This should do a pretty good stylized wood erosion effect. So let's set the intensity to, say, 0.1, and set the mode to min. And there we go. If we look now, set the intensity to 0, and then set the intensity to 0.1, you can see we get these little nice notches all along the edges of our surface, and in the wood grain here, it gets a little bit of a warping and a notching as well, which really lends to the idea that it's hand-painted. It gives an almost, it's like if you dropped a little bit of water on an oil paint kind of effect. It's really quite nice, I think. And again, it adds visual aesthetic qualities to the material. It really makes it look organic, which is everything that procedural design is about, just adding nice little bits of visual flair to really please the eye. So then the last thing is going to be adding our little splits in the wood, our little darts here. So let's go ahead and create that, which is going to be really, really simple. First thing we're going to do is add another polygon 2 with a triangle this time, which is going to be a little dart, a little split in the wood. I'm going to give it 0.25 of a turn, so it just flattens off the bottom. And I'm going to bring the gradient way down to maybe 0.2. And then, you know what, let's add a little bit of curvature to this as well, maybe 0.2 of curvature. So we get sort of a slightly rounded cut into our wood. I think that's going to look a little bit more stylized. So let's add Transform 2D, plug in our input, and start turning this, oops, I'm rotating, start grabbing our transforms, and start turning this into a little bit of an arrowhead shape, a little bit of a sharper dart. Now, we don't want it to tile, so for our tiling mode, I'm going to set this to absolute and no tiling. Let's just bring this little dart shape in until we get a nice, sharp little dart, and then let's bring it down a little bit. And one more time, we're going to copy our tile generator, paste, and this time use our darts, little darts here as our input. Now, I don't want this to have any luminance variation, because it's just going to be subtracted out of our material. Let's give us some room to blend this on top. In fact, I'm going to move all of this for our little splits in the wood over, so they're going to be more in line with our blend. Let's add another blend. And now I could... see, the problem is I want to blend these with the multiply, with basically like the multiply. I want these to be black and to sort of cut in to the surface here. Now what I could do is take this, add an invert grayscale node, so then I have white and black darts instead of white darts and black background. But there's actually a single step I could do, sort of eliminate adding another node, adding more processing time, really quick and simple. I'm just going to set this to the subtract mode, and then it subtracts the white areas out of the material, just like if it were a black material set to the multiply node, a mode. Now you can see these are a little bit out of line, they're a little bit too far downwards, but that's pretty simple. I just go to my transform 2D and move it up a little bit, move it up a little bit, and there we go, that's looking a lot nicer. Now, it's a little bit too dark, so maybe 0.75, 0.5 for our splits in our wood, and maybe 0.6. And now let's plug that into our normal information and take a look. Ah, but it leaves behind some of the wood, so let's actually turn it all the way up, because we want them to be pretty clean splits in the material. That's pretty good. The other thing is we don't want it to be tiled to the point that every single tile, wood tile in our pattern has its own little split. We only want it to be some of them. So let's go down to our random mask and turn that up to like 0.5. So then there's only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So only 5 of our tiles instead of all 16 are going to have splits in them. And there we go. It might still be a little bit on the thick side. We can thin that out a little bit with our transform. Let's go down to our ambient occlusion as well, and let's go ahead and tighten that up, brighten it up a little bit. Really make the ambient occlusion pop. It's part of our stylized look, is having really strong, prominent shadows in AO. I wouldn't usually do this in a photorealistic sense, having it be so dark and so punchy, but for a stylized aesthetic, I think it works pretty darn well. Alright, I think that's all of our surface done, so let's start moving into our base color. Now, I've seen a few questions about how to create customizable colors around forums, around the Facebook groups, and this is a really interesting technique, or a really useful technique that I found. So you can customize to any color you want. You can expose this parameter so you have a color picker in Unity 5 or Unreal Engine. I think this is a really cool technique, so I just want to share it with you guys. I'm going to add a blend node. I'm going to take our tiles down here that we use for our vector map. In fact, I'm actually going to use the ones for our gradient. Let's go ahead and use these. Because these... these have a little bit of gradient, which is also going to be a little bit of like a fake shadow effect, which is actually kind of what we want. If you look at our reference photo, there are sort of faked, baked shadows and lighting in most hand-painted textures. Sort of, you use the materials in almost a shadeless way, and the painting itself is actually where most of the lighting, quote-unquote lighting, in the materials come from. So I'm going to use these. But what I want to do is add a levels in between here and sort of make them a little bit less contrasty for this technique to work properly. So let's go ahead, bring down our contrast a little bit, and actually let's also bring down our luminance a little bit, because we need them to be sort of a vaguely gray color for this particular technique. And now I'm going to add a uniform color node, plug that into our input. And now you can see there's a little bit of an error there. You got this red line. Now the reason is this levels coming from our height information is grayscale, and the uniform color is color. and a blend node needs them both to be color or both to be grayscale to work properly. So we're going to take this levels, add a gradient map, tap D to collapse it, and now it's just sort of converted our grayscale into color. So then this node has two color inputs, and everything's happy. The uniform color slit optimization technique here, I can set the output size to absolute and turn it down to 16 by 16 without losing any information for this technique. And I just want to set it to any color. Now if I go to my blend and set this to overlay, you can see it's overlaying the color on our tiles underneath. So now I could expose this parameter, and then I have a color picker, and I can pick any color in the spectrum that I want. I'm going to use sort of a light teal kind of color, almost like this color. Maybe a little bit darker and more washed out even. And now it's just overlaying that color on top of our basic shapes, which is exactly what we want. That is exactly what we're looking for. And then we can expose this parameter, use a color picker, set this to any color we want at any time. That is absolutely perfect. That's brilliant. So let's go ahead and move these over just a touch. Get very OCD about my alignment of my nodes. And let's go ahead and expose our base color input and start plugging this in as we work with our base color. Looking pretty good. Now the next step is going to be adding the sort of highlights on the edges. If you look at most hand-painted materials, you have shadows, and you usually have like the beveled edges highlighted here in white. So how do we do that? Actually, let's go back to the beginning of the tutorial when I was saying curvature smooth is going to be useful. Look at that. Our curvature smooth actually looks a lot like what our hand-painted material wants to be. It highlights those edges. It highlights those bevels. That's exactly what we're looking for. So let's go ahead, add another blend node. Pop that as our background. Pop this as our foreground. Now, unfortunately, we get the red line of errors again because this curvature smooth is grayscale. So let's add another gradient map. Tap D to collapse it. And let's set the blending mode over here to say overlay again. And let's take a look. That's actually looking pretty good. Let's pop this in and see how it looks. Pretty good. I think I might want to add a levels. Play with the contrast just a little bit. Really sort of focus in on the light areas. And sort of get rid of some of the dark areas a little bit. So let's play with the contrast, make it a little bit more contrasty in the favor of the brighter areas of the image. But then also sort of remove some of the intensity from the darker areas. There we go. I think that's looking pretty okay. So now we have our sort of highlights along the edges of our bevels. Pretty cool, pretty cool. I think I want to go ahead and multiply or subtract out our little darts, our little splits in the wood here, so they are a little bit more prominent, a little bit more obvious. They don't really have any blackness, any shadows, any darkness here, so you can't really notice them as they should be. So let's add another blend, background, put our darts in the foreground again. Once again, grayscale issue, gradient map, and just subtract these out. Plug that into our base color. That might be a little bit too dark, perhaps. Let's try 0.5. Maybe 0.25, 0.35, 0.42. There we go. I think that's pretty good enough. So you get that little bit of, you get a little bit of color coming through still, but the splits are a lot more prominent, a lot more obvious. That's looking pretty good. And now the last and final step I'm going to be doing here is adding a little bit of random splotchiness to the surface to really suggest that it's hand-painted, that it's got paint involved. So one more blend for our base color. One more blend. Let's go to our noises. Let's try finding, I think our moisture noise is going to be really good because it's a mixture of sort of sharp and blurred, and it looks kind of almost like water paints that sort of have spread around. One more gradient map. Set it to overlay. Now let's bring the opacity way down to like 0.1, maybe 0.2. And in this case, I don't mind. I don't need to vector map this to the tiles. I don't really mind that it's sort of uniform splotchiness across the surface, because this is the effect of the artist's paintbrush, which is going to be uniform across the entire surface. The artist is going to want to make each individual tile have its own grain, and each tile should have its own grain, but the artist can't really help the fact that their brush is going to be sort of a uniform effect across the entire material, so that's less of an issue. And it's also, because it's such a subtle, soft effect, it's much less obvious. So we don't need to waste time vector mapping this. So let's plug this in and take a look. And I think that looks pretty good. All in all, I think that looks pretty good. Now from here, I might usually go into doing roughness. I'd take some of my base color inputs and some of my gradient map inputs and things like that, and I'd go ahead and create a roughness map. But if you look at most games that use a sort of hand-painted stylized texture material style, they usually use fairly flat shading, fairly shadeless materials, or they have a very clean effect with very little detail in the roughness maps, if any. You know, Overwatch, all these sorts of different things, they have some detail in the roughness maps, but not so much, because the point is to make a really clean, nice-looking material. So I'm not going to take too much time, in fact, any time, really, to really play with our roughness map here. In fact, I could probably just go to our roughness here and use, like, the default grunginess. Just add a little bit of grunge here. Turn up our grunge to, like, 0.6. So it's sort of... Oh, gosh, not even. 0.35, maybe. So it's just a little bit of a subtle effect, or 0.2. So it's a little bit of a subtle effect. You got some predetermined, or you can use a custom gradient input, but I don't want to get too far into it, because it's sort of... The more detail we put into sort of breaking up the light, the less stylized it's going to look, and the more... We're starting to get into the realm of photorealism, where it's going to look a little bit uncanny valley, having a stylized effect with realistic lighting coming off of it. So this is pretty much it. This is exactly the effect we were going for. Actually, not that complicated, but really, I think a nice looking result in the end. But it's got a lot of aesthetic value. So I hope you guys learned a few things, a few different techniques. You know, the vector mapping here I think is very useful, how to combine some shapes together, the idea of using curvature smooth to really sort of pull out the highlights in your material for hand-painted material, for hand-painted texture sets, that stylization. I hope this tutorial gave you a few ideas for how to use these nodes in new and creative ways. Definitely shoot me your own versions, images and whatever of your own versions, animations even if you want to. Shoot me that over at on Twitter, at Blackhart Films. I definitely want to see what you guys, your own creative takes on this whole technique here. And I hope this has been a useful tutorial. I hope you guys learned a few things, and have a great day, everybody. Actually, hang on a minute. Hold on. I do believe I mentioned at the beginning of this tutorial that I was going to go ahead and show you guys how to bring your texture sets out of Substance Designer and into your 3D software such as Blender, but it completely slipped my mind as I was going through the tutorial. I apologize. So let's go ahead. The first thing I said I was going to change is that I wouldn't use Curvature Smooth. I'd use raw height information, especially if I was going to use height maps for the tessellated micro displacement in Blender. So I can just plug in our raw height information into our height, and you might see in our viewport a slight subtle change, not a big change. You know, our curvature smooth works perfectly fine, especially for parallax occlusion in a real-time environment, but having the raw height information for micro displacement is just that slight bit better for use in, say, Blender for tessellated displacement. So now that we have all of our outputs set up, we're going to right-click on our material and hit Export Outputs as Bitmaps. Set it as, say, a JPEG output. I don't need to be PNG because I'm not using alpha maps at all, so the slight reduction in file size is going to be perfectly acceptable for me, especially for a tutorial, and especially for a hand-painted material, where, you know, tiny little details in resolution aren't going to be as important. So I'm just going to go ahead, select my folder, save all, and export my texture sets. And if I open these up, I have my ambient occlusion, my base color, my height information here, my normal. Of course, our metallic is completely black and empty because nothing in our material is metal. And our roughness is sort of a generic gray. In fact, I don't think on this version I added roughness information. So let's go to my base material. And let's add in a little bit of that roughness grunge to really sort of make things pop a little bit better. 0.25. Yeah. So let's save this once more. Export as bitmaps. Save all. And now my roughness map should have a little bit of a grunge and information in there. That's pretty nice. So let's go ahead, close down Substance, and open up Blender. All right, now that we're in Blender, let's go ahead and add a cube. I'm going to tab into edit mode and just do our basic cube unwrapping technique, you know, same way that you would unwrap any generic cube. Grab three sides on the bottom and each of the four sides here. Control E, mark seams, select all and unwrap them. And let's go ahead and set this to our UV image editor to just make sure that we got a good unwrap. That's looking pretty good to me. All right, cool. Now let's set this to our node editor as we work on our actual materials. I'm going to make sure that I have a HDRI environment map set up for natural lighting in my scene. And I'm going to go ahead and actually, let's make this cube a little bit less square. Let's make it a little bit more interesting. I'm going to go ahead and add the bevel modifier. Just turn the segments up to like 5, set smooth shading. And so now this should match the rounded cube that you see in the substance viewport just a little bit closer. Cool. All right, so now let's go ahead and start working on our materials. I'm going to be appending in my PBR Uber-Shader material that I have up on the Blender Market because I'm going to be using this. You don't have to. There are tutorials from, say, Andrew Price, the Blender Guru, or Cinecat Pro. I'm sure there are plenty of other tutorials out there for good PBR solutions. The only reason I like my own version is because I've specifically designed it for my own workflow, working between Unity and Blender and Substance especially. So it's my shader is designed specifically with PBR metal roughness texture sets from Substance or other PBR texture designers, 3D Coat, Quixel, what have you. It's designed with those in mind. So it's designed for the industry standard PBR texturing workflow, as opposed to like a generic PBR workflow that a lot of other tutorials sort of go over without actually considerations for the inputs. So I'm going to go to Append, grab my PBR shader, Node Tree, Substance PBR, Append, and for my block, I'm just going to add my PBR shader. Perfect. So now for my base color, of course I'm going to add a image texture. Let's open it up. Let's go to my demos, hand-painted demo, grab our base color, and actually let's go ahead and copy our directory so we don't have to find it every time. Base color, ambient occlusion, I can set to non-color data. Paste in our directory and grab our ambient occlusion. Now, I wouldn't usually use ambient occlusion, but for a stylized material like this, might as well. Let's grab roughness, image texture, non-color data, roughness. We don't need to grab our metallic because nothing's metal, so we don't have a metal in this map. That's really important. Let's grab our image texture for our normal map. Again, non-color data, normal map, and make sure that we have our normal strength turned up to say 1. And let's go ahead to rendered view and see how this looks. It's looking all right, although I think we need to tile it a little bit so we can really get a good view. So let's go to our material nodes here. Move these around so they're a little bit closer together. And so let's go ahead and do some mapping on this. Let's go ahead, add vector mapping. Connect that into all the vector inputs of our texture maps here. Whoops, that one's a little bit hidden. Whoopsies, here we go. Plug that all in, and then make sure that for our vector input, we go ahead and make sure it's using our UV map. Set the mapping to textured mode, and here's a little trick here. If you click, left click and hold and slide down, you can actually select multiple inputs, which is really useful if you're trying to move all the locations at once, or particularly for moving, changing all the scales at once, or anything. Any of these little slider boxes, setting boxes in anything in the Blender viewport, in the Blender settings, you can multi-click, which is really, really nice for doing everything at once. So I'm going to set my scale here to 0.25, so it scales 4x4, so we should get the tiles like we had in Substance Designer. Let's go back to our rendered view, and there we go. I might want to actually turn up our normal strength even more to say like 2 to really make the detail pop. But there we go. We have our stylized tiling material here, roof tile material, in the Blender viewport. Like I said, you could use any PBR setup that you wanted to use that accepts metal roughness texture sets. As far as I'm aware, there's not another one in the same price range, and there's not another freebie tutorial that I'm aware of for creating PBR metal roughness materials, at least not to the quality that I've designed them specifically for Substance Designer. But, you know, Andrew Price, Cinecat Pro, anyone else you find out there, if you want to use any other PBR workflows, definitely go right ahead. But I'll leave links in the description if you want to go ahead and pick this up to help you out with your own workflows. Anyway, that's how you create a material like this in Substance Designer for use in Unity and Unreal, or if you wanted to bring it into something like Blender, that's how you would do it as well. I hope this tutorial has been useful. I hope you guys learned a lot of different techniques, and have a great day, everybody.